NASA and modern astronomy say the Earth is a giant ball tilted back, wobbling and spinning 1,000 miles per hour around its central axis, traveling 67,000 miles per hour circles around the Sun, spiraling 500,000 miles per hour around the Milky Way, while the entire galaxy rockets a ridiculous 670 million miles through the universe, with all of these motions originating from an alleged Big Bang cosmogenic explosion 14 billion years ago. That's a grand total of 67,568,000 miles per hour in several different directions we're all supposedly speeding along at simultaneously, yet no one has ever seen, felt, heard, measured, or proven a single one of these motions to exist whatsoever. NASA and modern astronomy say Polaris, the North Pole star, is somewhere between 323 and 434 light-years, or about 2 quadrillion miles, away from us. Firstly, note that is between 1,938,000,000,000,000 to 2,604,000,000,000,000 miles, making a difference of over 600 trillion miles. If modern astronomy cannot even agree on the distance to stars within hundreds of trillions of miles, perhaps their science is flawed and their theory needs re-examining. However, even granting them their obscurely distant stars, it is impossible for heliocentrists to explain how Polaris manages to always remain perfectly aligned straight above the North Pole throughout Earth's various alleged tilting, wobbling, rotating, and revolving motions. Contemporaries of Copernicus, such as Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe, famously argued against his heliocentric model, positing that if the Earth revolved in an orbit around the Sun, the change in relative position of the stars after 6 months of orbital motion could not fail to be seen. Brahe wrote that the stars should seem to separate as we approach and come together as we recede. In actual fact, however, after millions of miles of supposed orbit around the Sun, not a single inch of parallax could be detected in the stars. As even Wikipedia notes, quote, "The lack of any observable parallax was considered a fatal flaw in any non-geocentric theory."
If a telescope is pointing at a star, and both are stationary, then obviously the light comes straight into the telescope. In 1729, Bradley found that he had to tip his telescope forward very slightly to get a star in the center of his telescope. It was assumed that this was due to the motion of the Earth around the Sun. Let us assume that the telescope was moving at 5 miles an hour and had to be tipped 5 degrees. This 5-degree tipping, however, could equally be caused by the ether moving at 5 miles an hour carrying the stars around the Earth. As we see here, the light would be coming in at the same angle and the telescope would still have to be tipped 5 degrees. So tipping the telescope does not tell us whether it is the starlight moving or the telescope moving. However, there is a simple experiment that can determine whether it was the Earth that was moving or the ether and starlight. All that you had to do was record the tipping required for any particular star, then fill the telescope with water, which greatly slows down the speed of light in the telescope. So here is the moving telescope filled with water, tipped at 5 degrees, and you can see that the starlight does not now reach the eyepiece at the bottom. This is because the starlight moves much more slowly when passing through water. However, if the telescope is tipped further, say 10 degrees, then the starlight will then be visible again in the eyepiece. It has to be tipped further because the light is now slower when in the telescope. But if the starlight is going past the telescope at 5 miles an hour, then when it is filled with water, no further tipping is needed because the light is coming in at 5 degrees anyway. The starlight stays on the same path, but is only travelling slower in the water. To recap, if it is the telescope that is moving, then when it is filled with water, it has to be tipped further to see the star. If the telescope is stationary and the starlight drifting past us, then it does not have to be tipped further. In 1871, George Biddell Airy, the Astronomer Royal, performed this experiment. This is a copy from his original report. You can see that the two readings are virtually identical. If it had been the telescope that was moving, Airy expected a figure of 30 seconds of arc. In fact, he only managed to read 0.8 seconds of arc difference. Bradley first discovered stellar aberration, and it is interesting that in his report, Airy mentions that it was now about 100 seconds of arc, and that it was still slowly diminishing. This indicates that the speed of light was still decreasing in measurable amounts when Airy performed his experiment in 1871. The result of Airy's experiment, known as Airy's failure, was that the telescope does not have to be tipped further. This proved that it was the incoming light that was moving past a stationary telescope fixed to the stationary Earth. What is interesting, in his very brief report of only 4 pages, is that not once did he refer to the astonishing results that the experiment proved, that the Earth was stationary. This experiment was also dismissed by Wikipedia, which said, "Ether drag test," under the main article, Luminiferous Ether. By means of a water-filled telescope, Airy, in 1871, looked for a change in stellar aberration through the refracting water due to an ether drag. Like in all other ether drift experiments, he obtained a negative result. This is a gross distortion of the truth. That he did not have to change the angle proved that it was the ether drifting past the stationary surface of the Earth. This experiment is never taught to university science students. They might begin to question what they were being taught about the cosmos, the universe, the Big Bang, evolution, and much else, if it was realized that the Earth really is at the center of the universe, which is rotating around us, as the Bible always clearly states.
Olber's paradox states that if there were billions of stars, which are suns, the night sky would be filled completely with light. As Edgar Allan Poe said, "Were the succession of stars endless, then the background of the sky would present us a uniform luminosity, since there could exist absolutely no point in all that background at which would not exist a star." In fact, Olber's paradox is no more a paradox than George Airy's experiment was a failure. Both are actually excellent refutations of the heliocentric spinning ball Earth model. Throughout thousands of years, the same constellations have remained fixed in their same patterns without moving out of position whatsoever. If the Earth were a big ball spinning around a bigger sun, spinning around a bigger galaxy, shooting off from the biggest bang, as NASA claims, it is impossible that the constellations would remain so fixed. Based on their model, we should, in fact, have an entirely different night sky every single night and never repeat exactly the same star pattern twice. If Earth were a spinning ball, it would be impossible to photograph star trail time lapses turning perfect circles around Polaris anywhere but the North Pole. At all other vantage points, the stars would be seen to travel more or less horizontally across the observer's horizon due to the alleged 1,000-mile-per-hour motion beneath their feet. In reality, however, Polaris's surrounding stars can always be photographed turning perfect circles around the central star all the way down to the Tropic of Capricorn. If Earth were a spinning ball revolving around the Sun, it would actually be impossible for star trail photos to show perfect circles even at the North Pole. Since the Earth is also allegedly moving 67,000 miles per hour around the Sun moving 500,000 miles per hour around the Milky Way, and the entire galaxy going 67 million miles per hour, these four contradictory motions would make star trail time lapses all show irregular curved lines.
Hello, it's me. You know, indoctrination started while we were still naive. Programming our beliefs. That inertia is the reason we don't feel the earth spinning. Hello, can you hear me? Did you ever stop to question the confession of gravity as a theory? Funny thing, force alone can be explained with buoyancy and density. The sun is closer than what they've told us, not 90 million miles away. Secret, the earth is stationary.